Hello, everyone. My name is Paul Ingracia.
And I'm Olivia Ingracia. We have another culture episode for you today revolving around film. This time, an analysis of The Godfather, Parts 1 and 2. There is never enough that can be said of Francis Ford Coppola and Mario Puzo's seminal trilogy, certainly masterpieces in every sense of the word. We hope to impart you, even the most die-hard of Godfather fans, with exclusive unknown information about these movies, which are universally considered two of the greatest movies ever made. Let's get started. I just want to mention that you should beware before watching this because we're going to be discussing major plot points and analyzing the shift in the characters throughout the film. This episode is more for the Godfather fan who has seen the movie multiple times. Of course, if you have just seen it once or haven't seen it yet, we urge you to see it again, but you could stick along at your own will, because we are going to discuss these plot points and some scenes. So this is for the fan who is a little more familiar with the film. So with that said, let's begin.
The Godfather is a 1972 American crime film directed by Francis Ford Coppola and produced by Albert S. Ruddy, based on Mario Puzo's best-selling novel of the same name. It stars Marlon Brando, who died 14 years ago this month, 2004, and Al Pacino as the leaders of a fictional New York crime family. The story, spanning from 1945 to 1955 over the course of the first two movies, chronicles the family under the patriarch Vito Corleone, played by Brando, focusing on the transformation of Michael Corleone, played by Al Pacino, from reluctant family outsider to ruthless mafia boss. The Godfather is critically acclaimed. It's considered one of the greatest films of all time. The American Film Institute ranked it third on its, I believe, both its 1997 list and its 2007 list.
I believe
list.
It was number two on its 2007
okay,
list.
Okay, so it was even upgraded on its more recent list as one of the greatest films of all time. The only two films that outranked that on the AFI's list were Citizen Kane and Casablanca, 1 and 2, respectively. It was selected for preservation in the U.S. National Film Registry of the Library of Congress in 1990, being deemed culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant, and is all around a masterpiece. It helped rejuvenate the career of Marlon Brando, who had gone through about a decade-long dry spell and kind of entrenched his legacy for one of the greatest actors of all time. He's ranked number 4 on the AFI's list of the top 25 male stars of the classic Golden Hollywood era. It also started the careers of the likes of Al Pacino, Robert Duvall, Talia Shire, James Caan, John Cazale, who played Fredo, and in part two, Robert De Niro, and so many others, all the actors who participate on this film. This was certainly a high point in their careers.
And definitely jump-started their careers and made them widely regarded in the film industry.
That's true. We did try to solicit James Caan for this show. Unfortunately, we weren't able to interview him at this time, but if either he or Pacino or Duvall or whoever might have been involved with the film is listening in, we'd love to
have you
on the show. And even De Niro, we could debate politics with you. So
yes.
The Godfather was released in 1972. It was based on the 1969 novel by Mario Puzo. This marked sort of a transformational time in the film industry. We see the ascendancy of the new Hollywood directors led by the Coppola's generation, the Spielbergs, the George Lucases, so on and so forth. So this is essentially the beginning of that generation of filmmaking, the directors who inherited this film legacy from the forefathers of Hollywood, of the golden years, the John Fords, the Capras. That generation essentially was turning it over to this new generation of directors who were educated, Coppola being a graduate of Hofstra and then I believe UCLA. This was pretty much the big major a starting point in his career as well.
But this movie was a difficult one to make, and Francis Ford Coppola had many issues with the studio, and the studio had many issues with Francis, which we will discuss later in this episode in a little while. But we first wanted to discuss the film score. The theme that you heard in the beginning was the main Godfather theme. That iconic theme was composed by Italian composer Nino Rota. He was a prolific Italian composer who previously worked with operas and ballets and many Italian themes prior to writing the score for The Godfather's Part 1, 2, and 3. In addition, Francis Ford Coppola's father, Carmine Coppola, wrote some of the tracks in the score, most notably the Connie's Wedding theme that was written by Francis Ford Coppola's father, Carmine. What is interesting about this is that The Godfather Part 1 was nominated to win an Oscar in 1972 for Best Film Score. However, it had to be withdrawn due to the fact that Nino Rota, the melody of The Godfather, the main theme that you heard in the beginning, was actually used by Nino Rota in an Italian film that he wrote in the 1950s. The film was called Fortunella, and it used that same theme. So it's very interesting that that iconic, you know, Godfather theme that is always associated with this movie was actually written for a more upbeat Italian film in the 50s. So that is why it did not go on to win. It was withdrawn, actually, from the Academy Awards. Then that's why it did not win in 1972. But Godfather Part II in 1974 ended up winning Best Film Score. Let's listen to that Fortunella melody, and let's hear the contrast from the beginning. So overall, you could tell that whether it's in Fortunella or adapted for The Godfather, this theme that Nino Rota wrote for this movie, I think does a great job at capturing that Italian heritage and the Italian culture. And then I think he does a great job with the waltzes and the various tarantella that he uses throughout in the different melodies and themes that really capture the Italian essence of the film.
And also, obviously, it was adapted from its original form to fit a movie that was certainly less upbeat and more somber and more dark and conveying all the images and ideas for which The Godfather is now famously known.
Right. And you see, I want to especially talk about the Part 2 film score. I particularly am fascinated by the different seemingly leitmotifs. That's a word used by Wagner in his operas. They're used to associate with a single character or a moment in the film. And I think Nino Rota and Carmine Coppola does a good job with this, especially in Don Fanucci's march during the festival in the streets. You have that feeling of death, you know, because he's the mob boss and he's controlling the city. And of course, you have the beautiful, flowing, more melodic, softer melody that's associated with Kay and Kay's theme, as well as the carpet theme, and that is in Godfather Part 2. Part 1 and Part 2, the film scores are brilliant. You could listen to them all day, even when you're not even watching the film. It really feels like a Sunday Italian, captured that Italian mood of The Godfather. A little death, but a little also family, and you feel that sense of culture really permeating through the music, and I think that's why it is such an iconic film score.
But now let's just take it back to Godfather Part 1 and talk a little bit about the difficulties involved for Francis Ford Coppola in getting this film made in the first place. There are many issues, especially surrounding his two starring personalities, Al Pacino, who was basically an unknown at the time, and Marlon Brando, who, as I mentioned earlier, his career was basically in limbo at this point after making several flops in the early 1960s, Mutiny on the Bounty, the remake, which Brando starred in, was one of those. Here's, in his own words, Coppola describing how he was able to solicit Brando.
And they just said, no, absolutely not. I won't quote his name, but they all sat there and finally they said, Francis, as president of Paramount Pictures, I want you to know formally that Marlon Brando will not appear in this motion picture, at which case I just threw myself on the ground. And they came back and they said to me, all right, we give you three conditions. A, he must do a screen test. B, he must put up a bond to ensure us that if any of his bad behavior causes a mess up of the production, that we can be reimbursed. And third, he must do the film for nothing. I said, okay. So I call up Brando, and I don't know him. I said, listen, as I'm doing this Godfather thing, and I didn't say you have to do it for nothing, and you have to. And I said, I just thought it would be wonderful if I could come and we could do a little few makeup tests. That was going to be the screen test. And I, so he said, all right, you know. So we arrive at his house early in the morning. And I brought like a little package. I always like to bring props for actors. So I brought like Italian cheese and little Italian cigars and little olives, and I just put them in little dishes, and he sees what I'm doing. Now, one thing about Marlon, he is like one very, 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 very intelligent man, so he kind of got the drift of what I was doing, and he says, this guy, he says, takes off his coat, and says, well, I was thinking that, you know, those guys, and he's putting up the ponytail, and I'm videotaping him, and you know, so he takes the cheese, and this is really how he did it. And meanwhile, he's putting shoe polish on his hair. He says, you know, he says, in the book, he gets shot in the throat, so I think you should talk, you know. I was like, he never got that. And then he says, he takes some tissue paper, and he says, it should be like a bulldog. He says, and he puts it in. And I'm amazed because this transformation is happening from this handsome guy with a ponytail into this Italian guy like my Uncle Louie. So now I had this extraordinary tape. So I figured, I'm going to take it to Charlie Bluthorn. And he sees Brando in a blonde pigtail, and he looks and he says, no, no, I told you, absolutely, absolutely, that's incredible.
And Coppola, being the director of this film, he always had this vision of who he wanted for each part. He discusses many times retrospectively, when reading the book and thinking about how he will create this movie, he says he knows he wants these actors. He knew he wanted Marlon Brando to portray Don Vito Corleone.
Yes, he said Brando was the only actor who can play the Godfather.
Right, and we know, till the end of his life, Frank Sinatra always said that he should have played the role of Don Vito Corleone. He felt as though he could portray it well.
Yeah.
We're big Frank fans, but we definitely side with Coppola in this and view that this part was perfectly casted in Marlon Brando.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously the crowning achievement of Brando's career. Anyone who thinks of Brando automatically associates him with The Godfather.
And what is interesting is that he only has 18 minutes of screen time. And he's only in part one. He's not in part two or part three, obviously, because he dies in part one. But he's only on the screen for 18 minutes.
And what's even more interesting, not to cut you off so abruptly right there, is that Contrary to what might be conventional knowledge, Brando is not Italian. He does not have a trace of Italian
in him.
No,
he does not.
He was actually Dutch.
Right, so this highly successful film, third greatest of all time, known for Marlon Brando, he wasn't even Italian, and he wasn't even in the film for more than 20 minutes. Very interesting stuff.
Speaking of the Italian or the backgrounds of our characters, Michael Corleone, Al Pacino, his grandparents, I believe, were from Corleone, Sicily. So, I mean, talk about
how
destiny.
Fate, yeah, how it was. He was supposed to have this part. I mean, Mario Puzo, when he was writing the part for Michael Corleone, he didn't have Al Pacino in mind. He was pretty much a no-name actor at the time. He hadn't had very many large roles. Obviously, The Godfather, brought his career into the great heights as it is today. But Francis, yes, and even all the other characters and the cast, they knew. Francis made known who he wanted to play the part. And of course, why don't we play the clip of Jimmy Caan, who was also considered for Michael Corleone,
as well as several other actors. This is a scene from this wonderful Godfather documentary. It's available on any box set that you might have, or any Blu-ray, I'm sure, of the Godfather film. But here's just the clip of several actors auditioning for that Michael Corleone part.
And one night I got a call from Francis, who was in New York, and he said, Jimmy, and I could tell from his voice this was not his idea, Jimmy, why don't you come in and test? I said, test what? What, do you got a Porsche? You want me to drive around the block? What do you want? Test what? He said, please, they want you to play Michael. What? Please, so I went in.
Michael?
Hmm?
Why are all those people bothering your father on a day like this?
Oh. Well, that's because they know no Sicilian can refuse a request on his daughter's wedding day.
Oh, good.
I don't think you can name an actor that wasn't there. They were all sitting around on cement floors from 7 in the morning to late at night. Guys with, some guys talk like this, you know. I mean, that guy's from all over the world.
And so the story goes.
The story goes that he killed 6 men in 2 weeks. He killed 6 men in 2 weeks. 6 men in 1 week. And he kept sneaking Al in, you know. At the end of the day, he kept testing Al, you know. It kept happening a lot. And it was countless. They went on and on. I remember saying at the time, you know, I just don't respond well to being around where I'm not wanted. I would rather, you know, it's tough enough, an actor, you know, rejection. Well, anyway, he just stayed with it. It was his tenacity, and that got me in there.
Luca Brasi held a gun to his head. And my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract.
Another great actor in the film is Robert Duvall, who plays Tom Hagen in the movie, the consigliere, the German-Irish lawyer, and the step-brother to the Corleone.
He's the reason why the Corleones are dubbed the Irish Gang, because they have this Irish consigliere, usually, or counselor, who is usually given to the Italian of the family, but of course.
And that's from the book. That particular.
Right, if you read the book, actually, there's a lot of backstory about Tom Hagen and Johnny Fontaine, the godson, who Brando famously slaps in the scene and says, you can act like a man. The book goes into those two characters a lot, and it's from their point of view from the first half. So it's a very... If you want to learn more about the movie and more about the characters, it's definitely a read for the Godfather fans. But the movies are obviously better, but the book does delve into more information.
Anyway, there's a great story that Robert Duvall always tells in interviews about the Godfather, where they're all eating dinner. The whole cast is together for the first time, along with Coppola and maybe Puzo. I'm not sure if he's there. They're all seated around a dinner table at Patsy's in Manhattan and doing a screenplay read-through where, you know, James Caan reads his lines, John Cazale reads his lines as Fredo, and you have Brando sort of at the end of the table mumbling through his line.
And because of his nature, he's always very soft-spoken, and that's why he gets the nickname Mumbles.
Frank called him Mumbles.
Right, Frank Sinatra calls him Mumbles because of the way that he talks.
So Sterling Hayden, who is the actor who plays McCluskey, the corrupt police officer in the
film.
Who
watches over Solotso.
Sterling Hayden, Brando was saying a line going on and on. Everyone started maybe even dozing off a bit. And then Sterling Hayden comes in with his loud, gruff Irish voice, and everyone jumps up. And that's always a great story that Duvall likes. Speaking of McCluskey, let's show that great scene, probably one of the most famous scenes from the movie. The movie is filled with famous scenes, but this is one of the most famous, that convinced the studio executives that Pacino
was right for the part of Michael Corleone.
I frisked him. He's clean.
Don't take too long.
So this is, if you remember, Clemenza planted the gun in the bathroom right behind the toilet. Pacino enters the bathroom right now and kind of struggles to grab that gun.
The gun behind the, it's an old-fashioned toilet at the top, and you have the gun hidden behind that. It's a very peaceful, calm dinner setting.
Maybe not peaceful, but foreboding. Yeah, but very eerily quiet, that's right.
Right. That's why Tessio, he's very familiar with all the Italian restaurants. It was played by Abe Vigoda, and he says, why don't we do Louis in the Bronx, which is, you know.
It used to be a restaurant. It's no longer actually a restaurant in the Bronx. It's now like a upholstery store or something. But the famous flooring used in this restaurant is still available, is still
intact.
Yeah, observable. If you go there today, you could just Google the location for that. But this looks like any restaurant on
there
Arthur Avenue in the Bronx.
There aren't many people sitting down in the restaurant. Yes, it's definitely a city restaurant. That long, it's narrow, but it's long. It's far back.
Eccolo, se tu mi capisci, no? Sei italiano come tuo padre.
Solotso speaking Sicilian.
Michael doesn't understand it totally. He's the American.
He saves two shots for the guy, the police detective who shoots him in the head, who punched him in the jaw.
So,
and so Solotso, who was trying to, he originally wanted the Don to take part in his drug deal business, but then the Don was not too fond of that idea and turned him off and said no to that. So that's why this is where it all started spiraling down. They were unable to assassinate the Don, and now Michael was tasked with this meeting to what was supposed to straighten out the business, but Michael just comes and shoots them both. Michael, of course, was not in the family business. This kind of initiated him into the family business and ultimately was the first step in him becoming the next Don to succeed his father. And Michael, of course, was a war hero. He fought in World War II before this, so he was a newcomer, and the father never wanted him to join the family business, but ultimately, with this scene, he did. And with this scene is where the Paramount Pictures were convinced that Al Pacino was correct for this part, because Francis wanted Al, but they were not too keen on him. But after the scene, they decided that, right, Al Pacino will play a good Michael Corleone.
You can't have a discussion. That was excellent. And also, I just wanted to not forget to mention that there is a restaurant that's still running today on Arthur Avenue called Mario's that was heavily scouted by the Godfather crew to be the location for this film. But for whatever reason, they chose Louis instead. But If a bit of history, if you're ever in the Bronx and you ever venture in that neighborhood, everything's fairly close together.
Right. These Mario's filming locations. Is also a great restaurant if you want to eat there. But
so that's just a bit of information. You can't have a discussion about The Godfather without mentioning the horse's head sequence. So why don't we play that right now? And which occurs in the storyline before the scene we just played, the Salozzo scene, which is sort of the build up where Michael Corleone finally becomes enters the process of becoming the malicious, cold-hearted,
tragic hero of the story.
So this is director Jack Woltz, who is based on the famous studio executive Harry Cohn, who was known as sort of a sinister, cold-hearted Hollywood mogul of the early days of Hollywood. So that was the basis for this character. And you could hear many flattering stories about Harry Cohn by Orson Welles online in interviews. It's
you have that Godfather theme that is just building up to this moment that he wakes up and realizes what's in his bed.
Kind of plays out like a horror sequence, and you see sort of elements of horror in these Godfather films.
And then he realizes.
The blood's on his hands, he removes the blankets.
And then he
there's his prize possession.
Yeah, his prize stallion that he was gonna put out for stud that he told Tom Hagen. That actually was a real horse head. They got it from the local butcher. It was already dead for the movie, but and the actor, he actually did not know that there was going to be a real horse head, so those screams were authentic.
Yeah, on that
in
take,
that he thought it would be, you know, maybe a fake, you know, stuffed well,
apparently
head.
He realized that the horse's head was coming, but the directors did not tell him when the head would be there to amplify the shock value of that scene and to create a more authentic, raw, organic feel from the character, and that certainly was expressed in that sequence.
Yeah, those authentic, raw, and organic screams from Woltz.
James Caan is funny in interviews. He's always, well, let's play that clip when he's always talking about the horse's head, how people would always approach him about that.
You know, the biggest question I got about the horrors was that a real horse? 80 people got killed. They want to know if the horse was a real horse. Like, nobody cared who died because everything was done. You know what I mean? It was for the sake of family.
It's funny also because Tom Hagen said, we're going to get into a war with all the five families. But Tom, or Robert Duvall, or whoever wrote the script, the Corleones are supposed to be one of the five families. But the Barzinis, the Corleones, the Cunios, the Stracis, and the Tattaglias, the Corleones were one of the five. That's just a little, you know, there's supposed to be the four other families, but after you watch it, how many times have we seen it?
Probably 50.
Yeah,
at least
a year. You pick up on these little.
And these five hats. Families are modeled after the New York
family.
Five families:
Bonanno, Colombo, Gambino, Genovese, and Lucchese.
On a serious note, the truth about the success of The Godfather has to solely do with Francis Coppola. I mean, I remember I was with Evans and all that when they were talking to Augusta Gravis and all of that, and I go, Francis. And the reason I say that is Francis is not a Brooklyn Italian. Francis is a Mediterranean Italian. His father was lead flautist for Toscanini, you know? They come from music and art and food and wine. I mean, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the kids were the same way. They were in cutting rooms when they were 4 years. They don't know about any wise guy stuff. He's the further, but therein lies the success.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Right on Point. Be sure to subscribe to us so that you are notified whenever we release a new episode. In addition, Make sure you follow us on Twitter at ROP Podcast, like us on Facebook at ROP Podcast, and follow us on Instagram at Right On Point. Finally, donate to us so that we can continue spreading our message by going to patreon.com/rightonpoint and become part of the conversation by writing to us at ROP@rightonpointpodcast.com, where your message may be read on air at the end of the show. Finally, visit our website at rightonpointpodcast.com, where you will find articles, news, extra content, and more.
So now, why don't we, you can't discuss the Godfather films without mentioning the baptism murders. And why don't we play that right now? Coppola uses such a dramatic interplay.
The organ sound, he's playing Bach's. And right before this scene, he plays Bach.
He shoots Mo Green right in the eye.
And you obviously have the dichotomy of Michael standing as godfather to Connie's baby, and now he's killing all the five heads of the families, renouncing Satan and all of his promises, and carrying out these murders at the culmination of the film.
He shoots right there Richard Conte, who played Barzini in the movie.
Very powerful, with the dripping of the holy water on the baby's head and the dripping of the blood from all the murders that just occurred.
So, I mean, that's such a powerful sequence, and everyone remembers this from the Godfather movies. It's what I think gives the Godfather movies the distinction of being beyond a typical mafia film that became so popular once the Godfather movies were released and are still popular today. The Godfather films, I wouldn't even categorize primarily as mafia films, as odd as that seems. They're kind of almost like modern Shakespeare. There's Shakespearean elements of it. Coppola has stated time and again in interviews that he was making sort of the updated version of King Lear, when you have a father and his three sons and the tragic downfall of his youngest son, mirrored a lot of Shakespeare and a lot of the classics. This is a movie suffused with classical imagery and themes, that it's truly unbelievable how much substance is packed into this film, be it overtly or sort of subliminally.
And this final scene with the culmination of all these murders at the climax of the film was emulated by other directors after this, and you see it also in Godfather Part II, how it all culminates into this one lasting poignant scene. And it's also interesting because, as we stated before, Coppola was not who the studio wanted to have direct it. They actually had a backup director following Coppola around the set because the studio was about to pull him out and fire him and replace him right away. So they had that replacement director behind him, following him. But ultimately, obviously, Coppola was successful in this endeavor, but it did not come easily.
Now, we're going to talk a little bit about Godfather Part II. I'm sorry. We'll talk about the Godfather films again in future episodes. But so here's a very austere clip from the Godfather Part II.
Get a little help,
and
close the deal fast.
It's between Michael and his brother, Fredo, who
be good for the family.
went against
you
Michael.
Believe that story? You believe that? He said there was something in it for me,
Fredo's,
on my own.
Fredo's the sort of dumb brother who was overlooked by Don Vito Corleone, who at this point in the story has been deceased for many years, and Michael has ascended to family.
Did you ever once think about that?
Send Fredo off to do this. Send Fredo off to do that. Let Fredo take care of some Mickey Mouse nightclub somewhere. Send Fredo to pick somebody up at the airport. I'm your older brother, Mike, and I was stepped over.
That's the way Pop wanted it.
It ain't the way I wanted it. I can handle things. I'm smart. Not like everybody says. Like dumb, I'm smart, and I want respect.
And when he delivers these lines, John Cazale is in his chair seated. Michael's hovering over him, suggesting a position of authority, of power. It's like he's almost being drowned in his chair.
Yeah,
it's wonderful acting.
Right. He just disowns him, and he's unable to...
He belongs to Roth.
You're nothing to me now. You're not a brother. You're not a friend. I don't want to know you.
You can even see the coldness emitting from Michael's breath,
the
cold air.
I don't want you near my house.
It's as though
when you see our mother,
he literally has lost his soul at this point.
And right, you talk about that, and many people have discussed whether Michael is a villain, ranked as a villain, or he's a tragic hero. We would definitely, as the story plays out, I mean, he goes as far as killing his own brother. He kills Tessio in part one, who was a strong counselor and friend of his father since even before his father joined the mafia. You see that in part two, obviously, the backstory with how they met and how they became friends in America. But the way that Michael is brought into this whole family business, and ultimately his power, he just wields it in the way that it gets out of hand. I mean, you see Kay yelling at him in that famous scene in the Hotel Washington in D.C. You see how this kind of unravels and his life unravels around him. And he has that emotional scene with his mother where he asks if it's ever possible to lose your family. So it's clearly that he may even realize that it has gone too far, but I wouldn't necessarily pose him as a victim. Would you agree? I mean, a villain. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I don't see Michael Corleone as the conventional villain that he's typically made out to be. I see him as a character who has obviously suffered a great deal, but at the same time has tried to sort of live up to this
he's
haunted
that his
by the ghost of his father,
exactly.
In a sense, and he haunted so much to the extent that he idealized his father's aspirations for him, for the family, for making them legitimate in a certain sense.
He wanted what was best for his family. He always wanted his family to be first. And he's like, even when the hack senator defames him and his family, he says it does not relate to my family. He wants to put what he knows is good and right and, you know, as the top of his life. But he's in the way that he is able to do this was why we have a tragic flaw of his. You know, he has to kill not everyone, just his enemies, as he tells Tom in the part two.
I want to go over another scene. This is the final scene of The Godfather Part 2, where the family is seated around the table. They're celebrating their father's birthday, which is coincided with the Pearl Harbor.
Hey, Mom, we don't have to talk about the war.
Hey, Beep, you talk to Carl, right?
This is obviously the flashback. This is the last scene of part two after the camera zooms in on Michael thinking back to
country ain't your blood. You remember that.
I don't feel that way.
Well, if you don't feel like that, why don't you just quit college and go to join the army?
I did. I enlisted in the Marines.
Big shock to the family.
What do you mean?
I mean, Pop had to pull a lot of strings to get your deferment.
I didn't ask for deferment.
This is, you see Michael getting away from the family business, and he's, He's going a different direction that ultimately is not where he ends up when you step away from the flashback.
Of course, you'll call it a tree.
Yeah, James Caan actually made a cameo for this scene, and he said he'd only do it if he was paid as much as he was in the first film, and that they worked in it. They agreed
they
on
did
that.
It. Yeah, and Brando was actually supposed to be in this scene, but he was never shown because of an issue with the
with his, him showing up.
Right. Yeah. So Francis had to rewrite the scene very quickly, and you know this is what came of it, which is a great scene, one of the best scenes in the. In the trilogy.
You gotta understand that your father has plans for you. Now, many times, he and I have talked about your future.
Talk to my father about my future. My future.
Mikey, he has high hopes for you.
Michael's straight out of Dartmouth College. He just graduated. Now he wants to pave his own path.
You're really stupid.
He's here. Come on.
Michael is just left there alone in solitude and in sort of this,
and that mirrors what he is. Then that was a flashback, and it goes back to him sitting alone in that final scene of part
two, which conveys the problems are more deeply seated than just, you know, the fact that he was thrown into this operation unwillingly or against his fate. And Vito,
right, this was years in the making. It
Vito, a man who believed in destiny from the books, it seems to be that Michael's fate was always destined to go down this path. I want to talk a little bit right before we wrap up about Johnny Fontaine. The character of Johnny Fontaine and the influence of Frank Sinatra on that character. I'm sorry, we're flipping all over the place, but Frank was the influence for this character of Johnny Fontaine. It's a lot of the movie actually specifically related to that character is based almost exactly on periods of Frank Sinatra's life. Where he was struggling in the early 1950s when he was married to Ava Gardner.
And he wanted to get this part and this role that was perfect for him. He needed to get this role, but the director would not enable him to do that because, you know, Ava Gardner, he ran off with her and was not focused maybe on the work. So this character of Johnny Fontaine was based on the story of Frank Sinatra, which is why Frank... was angry about this film and always was mad at Mario Puzo for, you know, spotlighting this, zeroing in on this mafia connection that Frank had.
We hope you enjoyed this Godfather episode of Right on Point. There's so much more we could talk about with these movies, and
and there will be so many more Godfather specials and content in the future. Hopefully, as we said in the beginning, we could have one of these actors on. I don't know if that's actually going to happen, but hopefully we do.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Right on Point podcast. Please head on over to our website, rightonpointpodcast.com, where you can keep track of our shows. Follow us on social media.
We want to hear from you, and we are passionate about responding to our listeners' feedback. In order to improve this experience for everyone, get involved by finding us on social media.
Follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/ROP podcast. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/ROP podcast.
Follow us on Instagram at Right on Point Podcast. Visit our Patreon page, please. Consider donating to our show. We could really appreciate your generosity and your donations. Our Patreon is patreon.com/rightonpoint. Email us your feedback at ROP@rightonpointpodcast.com. We will read your emails and respond to them on future shows. And now for the quote of the day from none other than Barzini. Take it away.
Times have changed. It's not like the old days, where we can do anything we want. A refusal is not the act of a friend. Don Corleone had all the judges and the politicians in New York. And he must share them. All it others use them. He must let us draw the water from the well. Certainly he can present a bill for such services. After all, We are not communists.
Now for the word of the day, here's another clip from the Godfather film.
But when it was your time, the Jew would be the one to hold the strings. Senator Corleone. Governor Corleone. Something.
Another peasant avante.
So the word of the day is peasant avante, which means 95 caliber. Thank you for listening to this episode of Right on Point. We hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. On behalf of Olivia Ingracia, I'm Paul Ingracia, and that's the way it is.